Welcome to the first event of our Legal and Policy Issues Staff Room here at FOSDEM 2021. We will have very exciting and interesting sessions and talks over the next 2 days. And my name is Alexander Sander. I'm FSFE's policy consultant, and I'm here the host of this very first session in the Staff Room. And I'm particularly pleased that we will start right at the beginning with an interview on the new open source strategy of the European Commission. And next to me is Evangelos Tsavalopoulos. He is the head of sector of the European Commission, DG, Digits, Corporate Service, Mobile Apps and Open Source Strategy Unit. Welcome, Evangelos.
Thank you very much. Hi, Alex. Thank you very much for this invitation. I'm very honored to be here with you. Thank you very much again. Thanks.
For our audience, this interview is pre-recorded, but you will have the chance to raise your questions if you have some after the interview in a live Q&A session. So we will be also online after this pre-recorded talk here at the Staff Room. So we will start this interview with the first question on the open source strategy itself. So EUPIS, or the European Commission, presented the strategy in October last year, and the commissioners adopted this open source strategy as a communication to the Commission. Could you tell us what this means and what's the aim of this strategy, please?
Thank you very much, Alexander, for this question, because I think with this question it's also an opportunity to clarify duties about what is a strategy and what is a communication to the Commission, because sometimes, you know, people see there is a strategy and there are some over expectations created. So I would like to clarify first of all that this strategy is a communication to the Commission. This is a strategy which is internal to the Commission only. It is not, you know, there are legal acts where they directly affect member states and European Union citizens. So it's not, so for example, you know, as like regulations or directives. This strategy is not, it's neither a directive nor a regulation. It is really internal to the European Commission. And I think it's very, very important that we clarify any misunderstandings regarding what is the target group of the strategy. So I would like to start with that. So I hope that by that I clarify any ambiguities regarding what is the strategy. And then regarding your question, I have to say that there are actually two layers involved in answering your question. So first of all, there is a high level. So I will have to say that the aim of the strategy is to leverage the transformative, innovative and collaborative power of open source. Of course, we encourage the sharing and reuse of software solutions of knowledge and of information. Well, we want to deliver better services that enrich society and focus on lowering the cost to that society. Now, more concretely, the strategy shows that after 2 decades of increasing experience with open source solutions everywhere in the European Commission, we are now in the process of establishing, how can I say, an open source working culture. So that's, let's say, the first layer. Now, second layer, which is a more practical one. So in practical terms, what we want to do with the strategy, the announcement of the strategy, is the starting point of an overhaul of all our household rules. So the goal of the strategy is to make it easier for the Commission to share its software solution as open source. So we believe that this is a very important change, of course, with a tangible outcome, which means that we'll have more open source solution made by and available for all the Commission.
Okay. And the strategy list 10 actions for its implementation to make this all happen, what you just mentioned. Could you briefly summarize the most important ones or the planned activities? So what can we expect in the next years here?
Yeah, well, as you know, there are 10 actions. So for the economies of time, I will focus not on the most important ones, but at least the ones that we are focusing now. Of course, the first one is the creation of the Open Source Program Office. So we have already done that. We have not finished yet. Now the OSPO, the Open Source Program Office, will become the go-between of all the open source related activities at the European Commission. So actually we consider the Open Source Program Office as the heartbeat of the planned actions, a very important action, and we consider as established but not fully implemented. So that's an important thing. So the second important action is action two, which is about making things open. It's about promoting the inner source default. So what we want to do with this action is that we want to try and remove all the barriers of sharing and using software within the Commission. So what we want to do is that we want to encourage all our software development teams to make the projects available to everyone inside the European Commission. Some of them already are doing that, but it's not done in a consistent way. So what we want to do is that we want to make sure that this is configured and happens for every project. So in simple words, is we want to make this the new default. Now, what else? Action four. Action four is about revising the software distribution. So what we want to make sure is that we want to make it easier to share our software with other member states and companies and, of course, EU citizens. That's what we want. We are already in the process of doing that. But in order to achieve this objective, first, we need to remove some existing legal barriers. So cutting red tape is not, you know, it's not easy. However, we want to have this. Our aim is that we have these new rules in place during 2021. And of course, this will enable a fair set of existing projects to become open source. Another action that we consider very important, and it's already ongoing, is the action five, is the iLabs. So the idea behind this action is to involve the open source community. So we want to host open source labs in order to safely evaluate and experiment with innovative open source solution. Actually, what we have done is that we have already reached out to all our colleagues in the various departments. By departments, I mean director generals, but for the sake of simplicity, let's call them departments of the European Commission. And we ask them for suggestions that could bring a benefit either to the Commission and or to EU citizens. And we were really surprised by the positive response that we received from the various teams across the European Commission, not only in the sense of providing ideas, but also they were also very eager to participate in the testing. Now, of course, also under these actions, we also want that together with open source communities, together with European SMEs, we aim to also to test the solution and to see if we should add them to our toolbox, either internally or working with colleagues in member states.
Okay, I see. Before we dive a bit more into the future and also on the Open Source Program Office, which is quite interesting, I think, let's have a look at the status quo. So the European Commission, like, to be honest, all other public services in Europe use plenty of proprietary software, and so they are also locked in by proprietary vendors. And does this open source strategy help to resolve these lock-ins? And if so, are there any concrete goals, or what are the measures to resolve this status quo at the moment?
Yeah, I fully understand why you ask the question. But first, allow me to say, I'm not sure that the term lock-in is the applicable one. I don't believe that we are locked into software. There is always a free choice of selecting software, and we are selecting software based on specific requirements. So I won't use the lock-in, but I understand for the why you use this. But honestly, I wouldn't call it a lock-in. Also, getting rid of proprietary software is not the scope of our open source strategy. An important starting point of our open source strategy is that and it's fundamental as a principle, is that open source will, of course, we want more open source, and of course, open source will be preferred when it is equivalent in terms of functionalities, cost, and security. And this principle actually is also part of the Commission's digital strategy. Of course, we want to make sure that more open source, but at the same time, we have to be pragmatic and realistic. And we have to really acknowledge that at this stage, there are some very good proprietary software solutions for which there is no open source equivalent. And or there are some open source equivalents that at this stage cannot provide the same, or in the foreseeable future, they do not provide an effective and efficient alternative. So we have to find the right balance, and that's very important.
But I mean, in general, you want to be on the way to use more free software and open source software to maybe overcome the situation that there is no equivalent software in place. And are you having statistics on this? So do you know how much free software you are using at the moment? Are you counting this? Do you have anything to see a progress, for example?
Yeah, thank you for that. Thank you for this, because that's another opportunity, you know, that we pass again the message that all this information is available publicly. And yes, of course, these numbers, and we have these figures thanks to EU-FOSA and EU-FOSA 2. And we had these two programs, thanks to the European Parliament. I have to say that all these figures have been available online since 2017. And you can find them on the EU-FOSA website. And I invite everybody, it's under JoinUp, to have a look at that, at these statistics. They are very, very interesting. And we have mentioned them extensively on the, you know, in various occasions in the Open Source Observatory, during presentations, media. And it will not be a surprise for you to find that, of course, among the top applications, it's Firefox and VLC. Just I would like to remind you know, to you and to the audience that are not familiar with FOSDEM 2, that EU-FOSDEM 2 aimed at exploring innovative methods for finding and fixing open source software vulnerabilities and at connecting with the wider open source developer community. And I would like to mention, because it's relevant to the statistics, that some of the key achievements of the project include inventories of open source software for the Commission and the European Council, and a comprehensive study on the trends and uses of open source software within public administrations worldwide. So it's very important that you find, yeah. And of course, EU-FOSDEM 2 covered a lot of ground, and it was very also instrumental in our transition and maturity in terms of embracing open source principle and in the way that we're going to change we work. So, coming back again, all the information is available. I encourage everybody that have a look.
So, and these numbers or these statistics will be also used for future. I mean, the FOSDEM project is from the past somehow. So are you going to continue this somehow also in order to evaluate and measure the success of the new strategy? Or what are your plans to measure the success of your strategy right now for the next years, until 2023?
Yeah. Well, as you know, that the strategy comes with an action plan that details how the Commission will encourage and leverage open source software development practices to co-create, share, and reuse across the organization. In addition to this internal focus on an open source working culture, the strategy and action plan provide for increasing outreach to open source communities. Now, with these internal and external activities, the strategy and the action plan constitute practical instruments to help achieve the digital transformation of the Commission. So I have to say that already by successfully accomplishing the actions that are referenced in the action plan is already a first very important indicator about the success of the new strategy. However, I want to say that also we are in the process of establishing some meaningful and at the same time realistic and pragmatic key performance indicators were, of course, applicable for tracking the progress against an established target objective. For example, such an example is the milestone for the revision of the software distribution practices. So if we implement this successfully, this distribution practice will result in an increase in more commissioned software projects becoming available as open source. So that's an example of how a KPI, a meaningful KPI, a pragmatic KPI, will be used to measure the success of the open source strategy.
Mm-hmm. Okay, I see. Maybe let's come back to the situation that you said there are at some point no free software solutions on the market, and also the strategy here says or indicates that there are a good reasons. That's what the strategy says, to choose non-open technologies. Also, it says that there might be a reason where it makes sense to release solutions under a free software license. So could you say what are good reasons to choose non-free software, and where does it make sense to choose free software, and to dive a bit into this, why or when do you choose free software and when do you choose non-free software?
Yeah. Well, of course, we agree that in many cases it makes sense that we make it, open. But we have to be pragmatic. So, this is, it's not a sprint. This is a marathon. It's a long, the transition is a long-term change management project. Okay, so we cannot force things. By forcing things, most probably will be counterproductive. So we need to talk to the teams, liaise with the teams, and give the choice to the development teams to share their code when they are ready for it. Okay. Mm-hmm. Of course, there are some instances where, of course, we cannot, some projects cannot be open. Let's say there are some projects that deal with sensitive data, confidential data. There, you understand, will not be able, at least immediately to open the code. But also there's another aspect, transforming an existing project to an open source might require some refactoring code. Mm-hmm. And this comes at a cost. And there is, cost and of course time. So there is a possibility that at this stage, let's say this year, because of lack of resources, because the resources are allocated to let's say maintaining, enhancing the project, or because of time, or because of budget, we might not be able to transform all project. It has to do with with organization and with proper planning. So that's why I'm saying that we cannot really force project to become overnight open source. So what we are here to do, we as open source, is to encourage these teams and assist the team based on, of course, on their priorities and budget availability and time to transform the existing projects to open source. As I said, this will take time, and we have to give the teams time to walk the path.
And how do you try to convince them? So what are your reasons you tell them to choose free software? So what are your reasons from the commission side to make software open? So how do you convince your colleagues? But also, you had some experience with free software in the past, as you said, for example, in the FOSDEM project. So how did you came up with this idea to have the strategy and convince your colleagues to choose more open or free software?
It's not clear, Alex, it's not clear the question.
I mean, you from the Commission side have reasons why you choose free software. So could you elaborate more on this? So why did you came up then with this strategy to say we want to have free software instead of proprietary software? So as you said, you want to go this marathon. So why are you going on the way now?
Of course. Sorry, Adrianus. Okay, thank you for this clarification. Now it's more clear to me the question. Well, the benefits of using open software, you know, I think it's, you know, clear to everybody. I mean, the code is public, free to reuse, and in a collaborative way, we can adapt and improve. Of course, you can inspect it for security reasons, for security issues. It's independent from and by that, we can create more interoperable systems. Sharing the Commission source code as information, it's our civic responsibility, okay? Of course, it lowers, eventually will lower cost for society. And at the same time, it increases knowledge. So it's also, you know, we also, what we do is we also build on our experience from the Connected Europe facility, the EU FOSA, the ISA Square program, including Join Up, and also, so we have partnerships with open source software service suppliers, with communities, and we also encourage pilots and other initiatives. So we have experience. So it's not something new to us. Don't forget also, which is very, very important, we also had a study on the open source software governance of the European Commission, which was made publicly available online. So the study was written by several experts in the area, and it shows that the open source strategy is in line with the best practices from public services and private companies. So this confirms our strengthened policy on the use of open source software, you know, as a norm. So,
yeah, I see. And maybe now, coming back to the Open Source Program Office, and as you just said, there's JoinUp, there's OSO, there's already so many. You had the FOSA project. So why do we need now this Open Source Program Office? What's its role? What shall it do? And yeah, could you tell us a bit more about this Open Source Program Office? Also, you said it's going to be set up soon. So maybe you have some information on that.
Yeah. What I wanted to clarify, many things. When I say that of course we have an open source program office. It's established. It is there. What I meant before is that this, we need to find our steps, and this will take time. So you know, it's more than a title. We need to establish best practices. We need to establish, you know, various aspects there. But the program office is there. But we need, you know, we need to get more mature. You know, find our steps, and this is happening. It's happening on a daily basis. We are collaborating with other organizations, institutions in Europe and across Europe. Sorry, and outside Europe, we want to, you know, share best practices. So there are still a lot of steps that we need to, you know, to follow, and so that the Open Source Program Office matures in an efficient and effective way. Now, as I said before, in the European Commission, we have more than 20 years of experience with open source. So what is important is to say that the OSPO, I mean, again, to remind that the open source strategy has 10 concrete actions. So one of the first action was, of course, which is, you know, to create the Open Source Program Office. So its main mission of the program office is to increase the use of open source, make it easier to contribute, and increasingly become part of open source communities. So that's the, let's say in a nutshell, the main mission of the OSPO. But at the same time, the Open Source Program Office has to assist in cutting the that I mentioned before, so that will make it easier for us to publish software as open source. I have to say that if it's not clear, I would It may sound, simple, but it's not. It's a massive task. And in order to change our household rules, it would take some time. And we have to actively involve all our colleagues across the Commission. And that's an important role of the Open Source Program Office. So that's, in short, what the OSPO will be busy with. So we want to make sure that we will bridge the internal process with the outside, finding and removing, of course, bottlenecks in the work processes, and strengthen the open, the collaboration between the open source communities and the Commission.
So as far as I stand, so there's an internal part, as the strategy itself says, it's an internal communication for sure, but you also want to be somehow connected to the outside world. So you won't be in your own bubble, but also want to be somehow open to the outside world. Maybe in this regard, the subtitle of the strategy is also Think Open. So is this also connected here, or what's the meaning of this subtitle? Is it for internal ideas, or does it also reflect this collaboration with external partners here?
Both. Of course, it's both. But as I said, because it's the strategy mainly concerns the European Commission, the title of the strategy, Think Open, signals a change in our internal mindset. That's important. It's not just a title, it's not just a buzzword, it's more than that. We want to change our mindset. So, of course, the development of software solutions take into account openness, sharing, reuse, security, privacy, and legal considerations, of course. And this Think Open is also indicates a commitment to actively support the open source developer communities. So, and it's worth talking about this a bit more, because the Commission strategy is giving us the space to join forces with major open source actors, but also with communities. So we will build, we will continue building and maintaining long-lasting and meaningful relationships with open source communities. And of course, we build on experience from other projects like Connecting Europe Facility, the EU FOSA, and the Asia Square. So all these actions will really contribute to the viability of the open source ecosystem and at the same time facilitate sound and efficient product management and governance.
Okay, I see. So on the one hand, you are very experienced, and on the other hand, you need to be open to the public somehow. And when you wrote this strategy paper, has there been also public consultations here, or was it more like an inside job? So how did you came up with this strategy? Did you ask communities or even the public or other entities here? Could you dive into this issue a bit?
Of course. Well, definitely the strategy was not created in isolation, and of course it was not just one entity creating this strategy. I would like to remind that the Commission has long studied experts, communities, think tanks, and groups of activists. So we have built a lot of relations with, in the context of the open source activities during the last 18 to 20 years. And I would like also to remind that in November in 2019, we also had a huge conference that brought together Europe's FOSS leaders. Now, we also in 2019, in view to this strategy, we had a very comprehensive study, which is entitled Study on Open Source Software Governance at the European Commission. And this study, which is available online, was conducted in close collaboration and cooperation with experts from all open source development communities. And as I said before, it shows that the open source strategy is in line with the best practices available. So, as you understand, of course, we consulted with all concerned parties.
I see. I see. And this is ongoing. So are you up to for consultations during this period as well, I guess. So as you just said, you will be think open not only internally but also externally. There will be also somehow these conferences and back and forth with outside communities as well in order to evaluate the strategy and to maybe adapt during the way activities.
It's not clear to me, Alex, about the evaluation and
I mean, as you just said, you had, for example, in 2019, this conference where you brought together free software communities and asked for feedback. And so I guess this is also what you're going to continue in the next years. So you won't stop this dialogue, but you're going to continue this dialogue, I guess.
Of course.
Yeah, and also what makes or what's really interesting for me is there any implications also for the member states? So I mean, sure, the Commission is an own entity, and but as you also want to work together with other administrations, and for example, the ISA Square project is really into administrations from all over Europe and not just from the Brussels bubble. So what's the idea here to work together with other member states? Especially administrations from the EU member states.
Yeah. Well, again, I have to remind that the strategy is internal to the Commission, but of course we see some implications for member states. I would like to give a very simple example, which is Leos. Leos is an open source solution which is used for writing, editing, and publishing legal text. And Leos is already used by one of the director generals, which is Digi Director General Taxud, which concerns custom union and tax policies. Leos is also used at the council, and Leos has been selected by the national governments in Spain and Germany. And besides Spain and Germany, other countries such as Denmark, Italy, and the Netherlands have also expressed their interest in this application. Spain is already working with our developers on new features, and Germany is putting more developers on the project. So, as you understand, this is an example of how we can create a software development community from various member states.
Yeah,
so,
perfect. So, yeah.
And it's also a good illustration, you know, how open source collaborate and have efficient resource management. And moreover, it shows how open source is about co-creation. It's about, you know, public services that connect seamlessly across organizational silos and borders. So what we're already doing with Leos, we can do with other projects as well.
Yeah, but that's true.
I would like to mention,
however we used.
No, what I want to say, what I want to say, and you seem a bit, you know, it's open source, you know, it's not the magical solution, it's not panacea, you know. It is a way to, you know, ensure if it's done properly, to achieve interoperability.
Yeah, that's true. And as we had this very impressive example across member states here in Europe, administrations are more or less having the same demands and needs worldwide. Yeah. So are you also planning to connect like globally? So are you also up to work together with third countries? And are there maybe already collaborations, or are there any planned collaborations? So what are your plans for opening your open source and free software activities globally?
Yeah. Well, as I mentioned before, regarding the open source program office, the We are participating in various meetings and discussions with various international organizations and ministries. For example, we are discussing with the Minister of Science and Technology of Israel. We are discussing with the United Nations. So, and the idea, you know, we want to keep our eyes and ears open, and we don't want to reinvent the wheel. We want to, you know, see and share best practices from others. And, you know, by sharing, you know, with these best practices, we can go faster to what we want to achieve. So, yes, we are in collaboration, in communication with other international organizations.
Yeah. Perfect. So, thanks a lot. I think we all now have a better understanding of the open source strategy of the European Commission, as well the difference between internal and internal communication and other legal documents we normally know from the European Commission, and also about the open source program office, the activities. Thank you very much for being here for this interview, and now we are going up we are going to open the floor to our audience to raise some other questions. For now, we will stop the pre-recorded interview, and we will all see you in a few seconds live at the Legal and Policy Dev Room here at FOSDEM 2021. Thanks a lot so far, and see you in a couple of seconds in the live session.
Thank you very much, Alex.
Thank you. Live. Okay, perfect. Awesome. So, hello everybody to this live Q&A session for the interview we just saw on the European Commission's open source strategy. The first question will be on the you said during the talk that there are some very good proprietary pieces of software that have no open source equivalent. And so the question here is, could you perhaps name one or two so that the people have a better understanding how this term equivalent is be judged and how you would describe it here?
The question is, I would like that we put this question in context. The open source strategy explicitly states that the open source alternative will be preferred when it meets the specific criteria, meaning it's equivalent to what we have, it matches also the security criteria prerequisites and some other criteria. So it is very, very important also to understand that when we select a product, it's not just a matter of cost, it's also a matter of integration. So it's also the total cost of ownership. So in this respect, when we select a product, we need to address all these requirements. So it's very important. So the question is not just about open source or proprietary. It's about at every time we select the most applicable product, whether open source or proprietary, that meets the established and expected criteria and needs of what we need. It's very, very important that we put this in context, mm-hmm. Alex.
And people in our community
may say that's why it's not a matter of, you know, and every time the choice is, you know, very specific. So, of course, it's, you know, we choose. And we cannot expect, as you know, we discussed, Alex, during the interview, we cannot expect that today we have, let's say, 100, it's an example, 50 proprietary software, and tomorrow we'll have, you know, 50 of them, 25 of them will be transformed to open source. It's not possible. As we discussed, we have to be pragmatic and realistic. And I will repeat again, what we are doing now, this is not sprint, it's a marathon. And we'll take some time. It will take time that we change. We just started. So change will come, but it will take some time. But every time we have, you know, this change is a conscious change. You see that in our strategy, And you will see that in the coming period with our actions.
Okay. And I think for our community, one of the most important questions one of the questions here is also the relationship or the contracts with Microsoft. So we would describe this as a lock-in for the EU here on of public administrations in general. There have been also the investigation by Investigate Europe, for example. How would you describe this in terms of equivalent software? So would you say that we or the European Commission have to stay with Microsoft for the next decades, or are you willing to or are you up to change, for example? So what's your take here?
Okay, let me this discussion about Microsoft has been going on I don't know for how many years. Is it only Microsoft?
No, for sure not. But you know, there have been investigation, and Microsoft is also every time in the spotlight. So I mean, there are many other companies, but people are always interested in case of Microsoft, right?
Of course, but this discussion, it's an endless discussion. I remember, as when I joined, the IT it has been there forever. This discussion, I think, it's not fair for anybody. This discussion, it's not only Microsoft about proprietary. Microsoft is not the evil. Okay, all these companies offer the proprietary products. They offer, very good products. And as I said, we do not consider that that we are locked in vendors. There are other companies that offer proprietary software. And every time, and I will repeat, the selection of software has to be seen in the specific context. I'll give you an example. We can use, let's say, in the development area, depending on the size of the volume of, of the needs of project, let's say web application, we might select that we use Oracle, or we might select that we use MySQL. So one is proprietary, the other is open source. Every time the need is very specific. And of course, they serve a strategic plan that the Commission, and not only the Commission, every organization has established regarding the digital transformation. In our case, we are discussing about the European Commission. So it's not only Microsoft. Now, of course, it's every tool, every software that we select has to serve a specific purpose, and it's not a light-hearted decision. It has to do with many aspects. With needs, with cost, with integration. Don't forget the integration, the interoperability with other existing systems. There are many aspects that are involved when we select a product.
That's for sure. So, but on the long run, you want to go in the direction of free software. That's why you have this strategy, and that's why this question comes up. That's for sure. And let's see how this will continue. Focus a bit on the open source part and free software part here. So the question is, your products you are developing in the next years, will they be just released as finished product, or will there be also open development here? So will you develop in the open, or how is the strategy handling this here?
Yeah, that's a very nice question, because it will give us an opportunity to clarify. I think we already touched that a bit in our interview. Of course, both. Of course, and it's mentioned in our strategy. Of course, we are reaching out to communities, and of course, we want that to have an open approach. Of course, it's both.
Okay,
and it's important. It's fundamental. It's fundamental.
And how do you decide if it's just releasing a finished product or deciding to develop in the open? So is there a guideline for this, or how do you decide on how to do it here?
Alex, we just started, so it depends. Okay. It depends on the case, I have to say. We have to see. But what is important is that, first of all, that we establish this dynamic interactivity. So for me, it's very, very important, and all will come. Everything will come.
Okay.
But it's very, very important that we pass a message that it is both.
Mm-hmm. Both. Okay. And also, I mean, we see in several countries, also European countries, that they have platforms to share code among administrations. And they're also having this open source program offices. And they, for example, help you to share these software pieces. Are you planning to do something similar here in Europe? Is there a planned platform for the public sector to join forces and to develop software together and to share and collaborate here? Or what can we expect here on this side?
I think I understood your question correctly. Example of Leos is an example of how we collaborate with with member states. So more examples will come. As I said before, and we discussed, the most important thing that we are doing now is removing the existing legal barriers, so that we will be able to offer our software as open source and allow our developers, our people, to participate in other projects, open source projects as well, and establish this collaboration with the open source communities across Europe. So we are going towards a direction.
Sure. I think it's a bit going in the different directions. For example, in France, we see ETHLab sharing this code, and we have for general projects something like GitLab. So are you planning to have something similar for the European Union and to host and share this code? Also, you have, for example, already JoinUp. So will this be somehow included? And what's the role of JoinUp, for example, for the future here?
Well, the JoinUp will be a very important part of what we're going to do. Replying to your question, the idea is that we also provide our software as open source, that we that will be available by everybody. So, of course, we're going towards a direction. And actually, already we are working internally on having in coming period some software that could be available to everybody.
Okay, and what's the role of JoinUp? Will this stay, or will this somehow be merged, or maybe could you, or do you already have ideas on this here? And
At this stage, JoinUp has a very specific role, a very specific scope. We have not yet fully analyzed how JoinUp will be part of what we're going to do, but definitely will play an important role.
Okay. And coming on the developing and releasing.
You, Alex, just to remind that also JoinUp is also, I would say, the JoinUp also will follow the evolution of the ISA Square program. So we have to see there.
Sorry, once again, I didn't get it. So JoinUp is connected to ISA Square, and so once ISA Square is
The future of JoinUp, it will also depend on the future of the ISA Square program. Mm-hmm. So, and
I guess you want to continue ISA Square, right? Or do you want to stop this at one point?
Of course. But ISA Square is different. It's a different program. That has to be clear to everybody. And again, I would like to mention again that, of course, we are going to establish a very strong interactive development system.
Okay. Another question on developing of software. So if the commission would be by default develop software as free software from the beginning, wouldn't step to transform software towards free software not be there anymore? So the question is on developing and transforming software. So I think once you start to develop software by your own, then you don't need to go to the market anymore and to see if there are any other solutions, on don't have to transform. You can start from scratch and then sharing and collaborating together and have the solution which is especially your needs and not the needs of a vendor, for example. So are you going more to this direction, or are you going more in the direction of transforming software somehow then?
Again, it depends on the need. Again, it depends, you know, what are the needs that a tool will have to serve. But definitely what is important is that we are going, you know, open by default.
And okay.
That's very important. And as we mentioned before, we are in the process of removing, you know, this existing legal barrier, which, you know, allow us to, you know, make our software open source. But at the same time, and again, we have to be pragmatic and realistic, there are some projects, for reasons, you know, we discussed during the interview, that will not be possible to make them open source. But in general, the idea is open source by default. And note, it's very, very important, I would like again to pass the message, it's not just open source only for the software development. You know, you during our interview, we discussed about the think open, you know, it's not by accident that it's, you know, we have this motto. It's not more than a motto. It's more than a buzzword. It's a change of mindset. We want to make, to ensure, to facilitate, we are all members of the OSPO, this change of mindset in the Commission. And by think open, it's not only about open source software. It's also about other things. It's about change of mindset. It's about open data. There is many, many things.
I see. And a question I think is quite interesting. So what have been the most difficult task for you during you wrote this strategy? And what do you see as the most difficult task for the next year? So where are the challenges for you for the next years? But also once you started work on this strategy, you also had an open source strategy for DigiDigit, for example, in the very beginning, then you opened it up. So what have been the challenges here? And what are the challenges for the future you see inside the European Commission?
Very nice question. And I see many questions within the question. So, yeah.
So let's start with the past. Yeah, so let's start kicking it out from DigiDigit to a European Commission strategy. Yeah. So let's was painful there?
There was no pain. That was painful at all. It was a fantastic experience for everybody involved. Because we, you know, this, as we said, this document is not anymore, you know, it's a strategy. So it's not just a, you know, an internal document. So what was, we had many things. I mean, we, you know, it's not something that came in isolation. First of all, we have previous open source, you know, internal documents that we have created. Every 3 years we're creating a similar document, but this time it was a strategy, which is a communication from the Commission, from the College to the Commission. So it was a synthesis. All the departments, all the Director Generals, so we as DG, we initiated to every department of the Commission, every Director General contributed to that. So it was a fantastic experience. I mean, in terms of a synthesis document, everybody contributed because, you know, you cannot have all the answers. So this synthesis was very, very nice. So we also had the study, you know, that we had the study about the future of open source in the European Commission. That was a very important instrument during, you know, for us in creating this new strategy. So I wouldn't say that, you know, it was something major there. And you see the outcome.
Everybody was happy that you opened the door and said you want to work more on the open source.
Well, it's not that we opened the door. These documents are by definition, by default, it's called inter-service consultation. For this type of documents, all DGs, all departments have to be consulted. It's not that we opened the door. It's there. This is a very specific procedure. It's very important that everybody understands this document is not done in isolation. There are many actors were involved, and it was a fantastic process. And the outcome, the outcome. Now, what are the main challenges? So I hope I asked the first part of the question. The second part of the question is what are the challenges that we see in the future? I would say that the first one, challenge, the first one is again this change of mindset. We want to, you know, to enter to engage in discussion with all our colleagues, with all the departments of the Commission, that we start thinking in a different way, this thing open. So I would say this is the first challenge, engage with all our colleagues and start passing the message. So that's why I repeat many times that this is not a sprint, it's a marathon, and it will take time. At the same time, and when I say challenge, I don't mean it. It's a positive challenge. It's not not in the wrong way, on the contrary, in a positive way. Another challenge, which is also a very important milestone, is the removal of the legal barrier. Important milestone. Another very nice, very, you know, that we are...
And maybe to come to this legal barrier. So what do you have to do here? So to give us an understanding, what can we expect? Legal barriers have to be removed, and
very soon, like? We hope, because we are discussing, you know, about the European Commission, and we discuss about legal aspects. Sometimes, you know, you have an idea about the timeline, but, you know, because it's a lengthy procedure, you know, sometimes you say Q2 and it comes to Q3. So that's why you see me, it's not avoiding to put a timeline, but definitely it will happen very soon. We won't, at this stage, we do not have the legal framework that we make our software open source. So we need to establish this legal framework, and then very soon we'll be able to share.
Is this on procurement procedure or what?
No, it's legal. It's pure legal.
Ah, okay. I see. Okay.
So very important. I know for enough, you know, for someone outside the Commission, this might seem a bit, bizarre. that we have to, but the Commission is, you know, it's a public, organization or a public service that is based on, you know, there is a legal framework.
Yeah, sure. And maybe as a last question, what I also think it's very interesting for all of us. So how can the global free soft community help you here? Do you see any needs or where we can step in and help you in order to be as fast as possible on your marathon?
Of course, all of you, the open source community is very important to us. That's why we are going to reach to you in the coming period. It's very, very important to us. As I mentioned, and I will mention that again, we do not operate in isolation. So we are going to establish, we already, you know, we know that we already have contacts, you know, with the open source communities. In the future, we are going to strengthen and enhance this, not just communication, but also collaboration. And you will see, you know, also based on our action plan, many things we're going to do, and this could be done also in collaboration with open source communities. So we really look forward to this collaboration, really.
Yeah, I think we as well. And also I think we now all have a better understanding of the open source strategy by the European Commission, by the interview, and also by attending this live Q&A session here. So thanks a lot for joining us here at the Dev Room, Legal and Policy Dev Room here at FOSDEM 2021. And thanks for being up for the questions. And I'm quite sure that we will stay in contact all together. Maybe next year we can have another talk on this and see what progress have been done so far. And it was really, really interesting for me. I hope for the audience as well. And hope to see you soon. And thanks a lot for being here.
Thanks a lot, Alex. Thank you to everybody. Thanks.